There was one piece missing from our example last time. So what I want to do is I want to spend a few minutes going over, reviewing the example that we had last time, the model that we had of client-server interaction. Then I want to bring in the missing piece. It's important that you understand how this works. Now, this may sound pretty basic or whatever, but it's important that you like really know exactly what's going on. Because if you don't like really understand the manner in which the client and the server communicate, then a lot of things are going to seem mysterious to you. All right, a lot of things you're going to look at is like, why did it work like that? Why doesn't this work? Magic. Whereas, yeah, exactly, magic, right. So if you do understand it, then it's like, oh, okay, that's why such and such behaves in a certain way. So we put up, first of all, our diagram of...
Yeah, are you recording?
Are you recording?
I am recording.
Are we recording?
We have recorded.
We're live. Is the camera on?
We have a client that goes through the internet and interacts with the server. And we talked about the most basic case of this is where the client is asking for a static HTML page. In other words, something that's just done in HTML. And we talked about this, that the server has a very easy job there. The server essentially just grabs the files that the client requests and sends them back to the client. And then the client's web browser views that. This is really what makes the web universal, right? Because remember, no matter what's going on the server end, what the client gets is a sandwich, right? What the client gets is a mix of HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and maybe some other stuff, okay? So if you're talking about a mobile phone browser or a desktop browser or a Mac versus Linux versus Windows versus whatever, all you have to do is build a web browser that understands the protocol of connecting and communicating via the internet and understands these languages, and you can access theoretically any web page in the world. All right? In the case of static web pages, these are already prepared and waiting. And all the server does is deliver them. You ask for this page, you get this page. We then talked about dynamic pages. And in dynamic pages, dynamic means it changes based on circumstances. All right? Some of the circumstances may be the location that you are at, where you're physically located at. Some of the conditions might be what you've typed into a form. For example, with Canvas, when you log on, you type a different username and password than me. Therefore, we may go to the same page from the server's perspective, but that page looks differently for you versus I because you versus me. Yeah. This isn't an English class, so I'm not worried about it. You versus me because the server did its thing and came up with different results. Just like both of us could go in the subway and order a turkey club, and yours, I might not be able to stand a bite out of yours, and you might not be able to stand a bite out of mine, because we customize it based on our input. All right? So the client makes a request, and that request contains a whole bunch of stuff. The URL that is being requested, the IP address of the client. The IP address can be used typically to determine the location, the approximate location. It's not like a GPS thing, but for example, we saw on Tuesday that it knew that we were like in the Elyria, Ohio area. All right, might not be able to pinpoint us exactly where we are, but the restaurants it gave were all in the Lorain County area, so it kind of knew where we were. information about the platform, about the browser and the operating system and so on. Form data. And a bunch of other stuff. In the case of dynamic pages, these things are not completed pages. They're effectively scripts, and the food analogy would be a recipe, instructions of how to make a page. So for example, if I was going to talk through how Canvas's homepage would look when you log into Canvas, it would first go and verify in a database that the credentials are correct, that the username and password are correct. Once it verified that, it would go and look up in the database to see what classes the person was enrolled in, what role they are in each class. In other words, I've taken classes here at LC, and for those classes back in Angel, all right, I didn't have instructor permissions because I was enrolled in the class as a student. It's possible, I've had people in my classes that were adjunct professors, and they would have control over their classes, but they would just be registered as a student in one of my classes. So it pulls all that information up, gives it to the server, along with the instructions, and the server pieces together a page custom made, ad hoc, you know, at the time it's requested, that matches the request and the credentials. So you get your page, I get mine. And as soon as the database is updated, then if you requested a page a second time, you would see the new results. So for example, let's say you turned in the first assignment and are sitting there anxious to know what you got on it. So you pull it up and it's not graded yet. Well, let's pretend you're really anxious and you sit there hitting the refresh button over and over and over again. And it keeps coming up saying not graded, not graded, not graded. Meanwhile, I'm waking up, I'm getting my cup of coffee, I'm feeding the cat, I'm looking in on the bunnies, doing all this stuff, and I finally say, okay, I better grade something, right? So I sit down and I start grading something. I look at yours, spectacular job. You know, there's not enough space in the text box for me to put the number of points that you deserve, so I'll just give you a 3 instead, all right? So I give you a 3 out of 3 on there and hit return. Sends it to the database, updates the database. The next time you hit refresh, you'll see that update, all right? Because this is like made for you on the spot. It's not like these are stored completed pages where some other process has to run. When you request the page is made. Just like in Subway, when you request a sandwich, the sandwich is made. They're not sitting there waiting for you. All right? Why? Because there's just simply too many possible combinations to do that. All right. The platform that we're going to be using for this is ASPX, or ASP.NET, and C Sharp. And this corresponds to sort of two files, the ASP.X, which is the UI portion of it, and the .CS file, which is the code behind, the code to process all this stuff and piece everything together. Any questions over this model? We'll get more into this today in the details how ASP works its magic. Keep in mind that this basic model is the same for any sort of server-side scripting technology. So we're talking about ASP.NET, but if this were a PHP class, I'd give the exact same lecture up to this point, and I'd write that we're running PHP instead of ASP.NET. So the concept of server-side scripting is identical. It doesn't matter if you're talking about PHP or Perl, Python, Ruby, any of these. All right? The concept is the same. Question?
Can you please go over that again? So ASP.NET, and what's it say to the left?
This?
Yeah.
UI. Oh, okay. User interface. And the .cs is the code. Other questions? piece here? What is the piece that we did not really talk too much about? Other than maybe writing two letters and a punctuation symbol on the board. JavaScript. We haven't talked about JavaScript. And JavaScript, sometimes people will call client-side scripting. The only difference here is there's alternatives for server-side scripting. There really are no alternatives to client-side scripting. It's JavaScript. Now, some people may be familiar with something called jQuery, but jQuery is just a set of libraries that's built on top of JavaScript. So it's like a souped-up version of JavaScript. So at its root, the only language that you have on the client side is JavaScript, which is a good thing, right? You wouldn't want to have to worry about implementing a whole bunch of different languages across a whole bunch of different browsers. Remember, all the server-side stuff happens on the server, and by the time it gets to the client, it's just a plain old web page consisting of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. That's why there's no browser compatibility with ASP.NET. No intrinsic browser compatibility. Now, the HTML that it produces could be screwy on one browser versus another, but it's not like, gee, I need Windows to run ASP.NET because the client doesn't see ASP.NET code. The server does all the work to produce it and gives it a web page. And again, by definition, the clients understand web pages. JavaScript is client-side scripting, and the idea of it is this typically is some sort of computing device. All right? It could be a bunch of different things, right? It could be a desktop machine, it could be a laptop, it could be a tablet, a mobile phone, it could be a flip phone, all right? It could be my Nintendo DS, it could be me viewing web pages through other video gaming system, could be a bunch of things. But the idea here is that there is typically going to be some processing power here for everything except maybe a flip phone. That's going to not really have a lot of processing power, all right? But the fact is that this is a device, too, that probably has some processing power. So how can we leverage that processing power? I mean, you have a great, powerful computer, you know, and it's a, you know, 64-core computer with, you know, a zillion tetrabytes of data and all that. And all it's doing is really... Pardon me?
You forgot about hyper-threading.
Hyper-threading, yeah. What a quantum machine, and, you know, it does all sorts of things and all that. And all it's doing, really, with web pages is it's just displaying web pages, just displaying HTML when you're browsing the web. All right? That's like, almost like, gee, couldn't we take advantage of some of the processing power on it? Well, that's what JavaScript comes in. JavaScript kind of is a response to the recognition that, hey, on the other end is probably some sort of computing device that can process programs itself. So if we can move some of the processing over to that, we're going to have a win-win situation. All right. Since I love food analogies, let me continue with another food analogy. About the same, except we've, you know, it's payday, so we're no longer going to fast food places like McDonald's and Subway. So we're going to go to a fancy sit-down restaurant. All right? So I go down to a fancy sit-down restaurant, and, you know, gee, when I say what I order, you're going to think, boy, he thinks that's a fancy restaurant, but yeah, it's fancy for me. If you're sitting down at a table and someone's taking your order, it's a fancy restaurant for me. All right? So I go in there and I order waffles, right? Because it's great to eat dinner for breakfast for dinner, right? So I go in and order waffles. So, and coffee. So the server comes and eventually gives me my waffles and puts on my table syrup and puts on my table, you know, sugar for the coffee, cream for the coffee, and so on. Now, in this analogy, we'll consider everyone that works for the restaurant to be the server, not just the waiter, all right? But everyone that works in the restaurant to be the server. Now, They give me some things that I can use to sort of customize my dinner without getting them involved at all. All right? In other words, you know, I like a lot of syrup, right? So I'm going to put a lot of syrup on it. If they put syrup on it, it wouldn't be enough. I can almost guarantee it. So can you imagine if they didn't leave the little bottle of syrup there? So I eat the first piece of waffle and I use up all the syrup on the first piece and I need more syrup to continue eating. I would have to flag the waiter down and say, waiter, I need more syrup. So the waiter would walk back to the kitchen, grab the bottle of syrup, walk over and pour a little bit on and then take the jar back or take the container back. Well, what's going to happen in another minute? I'm going to eat another piece of the waffle. I'm going to be out of syrup again. All right. I'm going to flag them over again. Now, who is happy? Who is going to be happy with the situation? No one, right? Because I would assume that I'm not the only client in the restaurant, right? And therefore, it might take a minute for the server to get to me. You know, the server is taking that other person's order while I'm sitting there watching my waffle get cold, waiting for some more syrup, right? So I'm not going to be happy. Have any of you ever worked in a restaurant as like a wait staff? Would you have enjoyed doing that? I don't think so, all right? It's going to be a pain for the client. It's going to be a pain for the server. So what do they do in restaurants? Well, they give you some tools so you can take care of yourself without bothering the server, all right? That's a win-win situation. How is it a win for the client? Well, it's a win for a client because they get their needs served quicker. In other words, I don't have to wait for the waiter to wander over, ask me if everything's okay, me saying I need more syrup, and then flag them down the next time and the next time and the next time. All right? So it's a win for me because I get a immediate response. I want more syrup. I take it and pour it on, and I got more syrup. Virtually instantaneously, right? Instantaneous at least compared to the amount of time it would take me to flag down a waiter, have the waiter walk back to the kitchen, get the syrup, come back, pour it on my waffle, and then walk back to the thing. So it was virtually instantaneous for me. So I'm happy because of that. You think the server's happier? Absolutely. They don't have to handle all these little tiny requests that the client could do just as well as they could. All right? So, that's sort of what JavaScript is. What comes over is code that you can use to make small changes to the thing that was delivered to you. All right? In this case, pour syrup on your waffles. In other terms, it might be something like display a pop-up menu. All right, let's bring up an example.
You made me realize that Olive Garden needs to leave the cheese grater at the table. Yes.
Well, we'll talk about that in a second. Why maybe they don't do that. I was not going to do that analogies specifically, but we were going to talk about, like, well, why do they even then bother with cooks and waiters? Why not just say, here's the kitchen, cook yourself up a steak, you know, pay us on the way out, you know? So that's the logical question, that, like, geez, if the client can do this stuff, where do you draw the line? Why don't you let them do everything? All right. Go to ESPN. All right. Notice what we have at ESPN. What happened there? I made a request. I made a request how? By typing in the URL. That request got routed through the internet, through Don Huffman's house and back out and to the internet. Wherever ESPN server lives, it made it to ESPN server. ESPN server found the files it need. It probably is running server-side scripting, so it probably did all the processing it needed to do. You know, read a database to find out, like, what the baseball scores were for last night, right? Because they probably don't have a developer sitting there typing in the scores. All right, they probably have a database that gets updated, and then it can be used throughout there. All right, and it prepared a web page, which is an HTML document. Now, we can look at the HTML document by saying, view source. But it's not terribly intelligible. Well, actually, this is fairly intelligible. You see just plain old HTML, right? So even though this is generated by server-side script, what gets delivered to me, the client, plain old HTML. Interestingly enough, notice on the sign, suggested Browns, Cleveland, Browns and Cavaliers, I mean, which means one of two things, right? It knows that I'm in the Cleveland area, or it knows that I'm a loser, one of the two, all right? Probably it knows that I'm in the Cleveland area because I haven't divulged enough information for them to make that call yet. All right, and Indians, Ohio State. So yeah, it knows where I am. So there's even these subtle sort of customizations. You know, if you go to certain news pages, for example, it might show you like weather for the Cleveland area. You know, almost so subtle that you don't even really realize it. But how does it do that? Well, it got my IP address. It looked up the IP address, Elyria, Ohio. It's smart enough even to know that Elyria, Ohio is closer to, say, Cleveland, to show the Cleveland Indians, as opposed to maybe Detroit. You know, Toledo would be maybe closer to Detroit than it is to Cleveland, or closer to Cincinnati, or whatever. All right? So it customized my page. Now, so far, everything that we've seen, it happened on the server in order to prepare this page. Now here comes putting the syrup on the waffles, okay? Because as I navigate around, what if I say, hey, I want to see what's going on in the NBA? I put my mouse over that, and I get a pop-down menu. All right? Notice how quickly that happened. Instantaneously. All right? When I first go to the page, it doesn't take long because we have a fast internet connection at least once in a while here. All right? But it took a minute. Not a minute, but a few seconds of time to actually display the whole page. But to display this, instantaneous. Also, another subtle thing that might be easy to miss is notice that if I refresh the page, the status down here changes. Waiting, waiting, waiting. Processing. Blah, 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 and there's my page. Whereas if I make a change here, I don't see like any sort of processing. These are all clues, the instantaneous nature of it, and the fact that we don't see any like server interactivity shows that this isn't making a request to the server, getting a response and coming back. So what did happen? Well, what happened is when the page was delivered, In addition to all the HTML and stuff that we saw, it gave us a bunch of HTML that we don't see yet. And it hid it. How did it hide it? Via CSS. Right? We use CSS to handle the appearance of stuff. Well, one aspect of the appearance is not appearing, alright? So through CSS, we can make something invisible or make it not display. Through JavaScript, we can dynamically change that to say, that thing that you weren't showing a minute ago, show it now. And as I move my mouse to the next thing, show that, show that, show that. I move my mouse off of it, and the menu, and everything goes away. So that's what JavaScript does. It provides a win-win situation. It's a win for me because my menu changes instantaneously. Like, what if I'm like, well, I want to see what's going on in the NFL. No, wait, I meant the NBA. All right? If I had to wait for the server to go do its thing and display the NFL and then wait for it again to do, it would be a very sort of clunky interaction. And I really wouldn't be This sort of scheme wouldn't work. Or especially if I was on a slower internet connection and I had to go to the server to get this stuff and come back. I can essentially prove to you that this HTML came, I hope. Let's view the page source. And let's look for something that wasn't on the home page. 76 errors. Okay, I lied. Keep in mind that without seeing the details of this, that might be a graphic actually, as opposed to text. Let's look for a draft. Kind of lost the plot here, but there are a number of different ways that this could be done, so maybe the details of what I'm saying aren't accurate, but you sort of get the idea that the menu got delivered, and as we go and put our mouse over this, we see dynamically the page change. Now the question is, the cheese grater on the Olive Garden, why don't they do that? Why don't they leave the cheese grater on the Olive Garden?
They don't want you to use up all the cheese.
They don't want you to use up all the cheese. Aren't they concerned that you're going to use up all the salt?
It's less expensive. Yeah.
Salt is less expensive than cheese.
You could hurt yourself on the cheese grater.
You could hurt yourself on the cheese grater. And you know what? Laugh if you wish. That's very true. Alright?
Gives the server something to do?
Maybe, but I would assume that they're not looking for work for their employees to do, that they have sufficient work. But, think about it. The expensiveness of the resource. The security risk for that. Could you see the headlines of the paper? So-and-so lops off finger on cheese grater at the Olive Garden. That wouldn't really be very good for business. Alright? So to protect the client and to protect the server in the institution, and when resources are expensive or risky, you keep those away from the client and you let them just do the easy, straightforward stuff. So, for example, how does this relate to web data to the web? You wouldn't want the client to be able to access the server's database directly without going through the server. That's a security nightmare. All right. Now, it would be difficult to arrange for that because, again, the typical client wouldn't have the tools to do that. So the whole point of the web is that the client doesn't need much at its end, just a web browser. So that would be sort of counter the main philosophy of the web, that the client doesn't need much, just a browser, and the server does all the heavy lifting. All right. So that would be a security nightmare, even if you could do it. Just, and again, the risk, the expensiveness of putting your data out there would be high. So again, that's why they don't say, well, here, go cook your steak and whatever. You know, steak's an expensive resource compared to, say, rolls. They might put a stack of rolls on your desk or the giant bowl of salad, all right? And so on. So therefore, they do that to protect themselves and to protect you and protect their expensive, valuable resources. So that's why the client doesn't do everything. All right. Questions about this? Now,
I wasn't able to find the search terms, or I wasn't sure if I found the search terms on this page, because again, it could be using a slightly different technique that we'll talk about now. All right. Here's something that is very difficult to explain from a traditional client-server model. If you go to Google, I go up here, I type in H. What does it show me? It shows me the four most popular searches that start with H. Hotmail is still around? Type in HT. Shows me the four most popular searches with HT. M shows me the four most popular searches with HT, M, and so on down the line. Let's think about this for a second. The response was virtually immediate. All right? That would tend to imply that something is going on the client side, right? Because we talked before about immediate response sort of implies that you're doing it on the client side. Yeah, if you think about it, there's some database interactivity going on here, right? In other words, it's not randomly picking words that start with H, then HT, then HTM, and so on. It's looking at some database to determine, and it's in doing database interactivity is a server-side thing, right? Remember, we talked before about we wouldn't want the client to be able, even if they could, we wouldn't want them able to interact with the database. So what's going on here, all right? What's going on here is the client and the server are talking, but they're talking in a different style of talking. The traditional client-server interaction is the client asks for a page, complete web page, either by typing in a URL or clicking a link, and the server responds back with an entire page. So when I type in ESPN.com, I'm asking for ESPN's homepage. It delivers me a complete web page. What's going on here is a little different. As I press a keystroke, all right, it goes and asks the server, not for an entire brand new web page, just a little tiny piece of it to change. Just a little tiny piece of it to change. In other words, it's asking the server for four phrases. How much bandwidth does four phrases take? Well, it depends on exactly how you send it back, but there's probably not even 100 characters worth there. So that is minimal in terms of transferring from the server. All right? It's minimal in terms of transferring from the server. So in the case of AJAX, the client actually makes a different sort of request. It doesn't request a page, it asks for a piece of data. It asks for some data. The server responds with just the data, not the whole page. So the server can respond quicker because it's not making a whole web page, it's just making like a little piece of data. And the client can take that data and reformat the page, and it can do that very quickly. Because if all the server's doing is giving back some data, then it's the client's job to display that data and to format it the way that it ought to be. So this is a mix of JavaScript and server-side scripting technology, but in a more fluid sort of interaction, not the clunky ask for a page, get back a page. Here I'm asking for a piece of data, getting back a piece of data. So if we can alter our diagram a little bit, this is a HTTP request, and this is a
HTTP response. So that's a kind of request that the client makes. An HTTP request is a request for a whole web page. The response that comes back is a whole web page. The other kind of request is called an XML HTTP request. It's still a request, so it's going to have a lot of this stuff. It's going to have a URL, form data, etc. Because, you know, when Google was showing me the results, it was based on what I typed in the text box, so the form data is still relevant. So pretty much the request is almost the same as the request here, except the request made is using a different protocol. It's asking the server for this sort of request. And the response is a piece of data. All right. Now, towards the end of the course, we will more than likely, unless there's some time constraints or something, we'll more likely talk about how this works in the ASP.NET world. Your luck, I don't know if you're lucky or not. In this class, we don't focus on the nuts and bolts of this. We just talk about how to make it work in the ASP.NET world. CISS 232, we talk about the nuts and bolts of this, how this works. One thing that might be a little counterintuitive is that even though the name says XML HTTP request, you might think, well, the server sends back XML. Not necessarily. A lot of times it does, but sometimes it doesn't. So, I don't know, it's one of those things that's kind of misnamed. But anyhow, that's the name of it. So, the idea of this is the server sort of does the same thing, except the server doesn't send a full web page, the server sends back data in some form or another. The next step is that the client has JavaScript to reformat the page. In other words, when the page was originally requested, when I went and typed in www.google.com, I got the HTML, the JavaScript to make the request to the server, and the JavaScript to handle the response from the server. So then when I do my thing and type it in, and the server sends back the data, the client already knows what to do with it. So this allows for a much more fluid sort of interaction. That's why, like, if you play with some, like, really good web apps, it's almost like running a desktop app, right? You know, like Gmail, you know, you go into Gmail and you get an email and boom, it pops up. Right? You don't have to sit there clicking refresh. It just automatically pops up. All right? Or in Google Documents, it automatically saves things for you. And it, you know, as you make changes and another person could be changing the same document, you both see each other's changes. You know, all kinds of great sort of things happen. Where it almost acts more like a desktop app. And the reason is we've gotten rid of the clunky interaction of asking for a whole page, getting back a whole page, or just sending data back and forth. This is the whole picture. The focus on this class will be on the server side. However, we need to be aware of the JavaScript aspect too, because ASP.NET code produces HTML, CSS, etc., but it also produces JavaScript. Here's sort of a TLDR version of the lecture to this point. All right? The server is responsible for making web pages. The client is responsible for
dealing with web pages that have already been created. All right. So in other words, taking the web page that's displayed and showing a different menu on it. All right. Or validating a form that you have already gotten from the server. And then there's AJAX, which we'll review later on in the term. So, creating a web page, manipulating a web page. All right? Questions at this point? All right. What we're going to do now is talk about how ASP.NET helps you to make web pages. All right? Quiz would be a horrible thing to say, so I won't say that. All right. But if we were going to have a quiz, let's imagine I asked you to create the HTML for a calendar. All right. In other words, you need to make an August calendar for a web page. All right, just a calendar that shows the days. We'll forget about like putting actual like descriptions of the days or appointments or whatever. Let's say we're just going to make a calendar. What would your HTML code look like?
Giant table.
Be a table. Be a giant table. So it'd be a table. Because really a calendar is a table. It's a table of weeks and days. All right, the columns are the days, the rows are the weeks. All right, so yeah, it'd be a table. How many rows would this table have?
4 to 6, depending on
the month. Yeah, depends on the month. I don't know what this August was, but 4, 5, 6, depending on the month and so on. So we'll average that out and say there would be 5 rows. I don't have to literally write 5 different rows. All right, so that'd be 5 of these. This times 5. All right. What would each row consist of?
Seven columns
or 7 TDs.
This is a math, right?
Pardon me?
This is a math going on in here.
So the first row would probably be THs to show the day of the week. And then I will draw another row. And the next row would be like the number of the day. In this case, let's say the first was on a Sunday. And then you'd have 7 of these. And it'd be 4 of these. And then just be one of these. So you'd have 5, 6, or 7 rows. The first row would have THs for the days of the week. Each subsequent row would have TDs in it, 7 of them. And then you put the numbers in the proper place. Would this be hard to do?
It would be tedious, I guess.
It would be tedious, yeah. Exactly. This is not hard HTML. I would expect pretty much everyone that went through the CISS 216 class to be able to write the code for this pretty easily, although I would expect a lot of sighing and eye rolling and expressions of disgust. All right? Because this is, it's not hard work, but it's a lot of work. All right. This brings us to sort of the philosophy between ASP.NET or behind ASP.NET and the ASP.NET framework. Would you be the only person in the world that needed to put a calendar on your web page? No. Does every web page have them? No.
Do a lot of web pages have them? Yes. So the idea of a framework which is what ASP.NET ultimately is that it takes something that is done often and makes it easy to do. It's sort of like, it doesn't have to even be complicated things that are done often. This isn't complicated, but it's time consuming, it's tedious. Hey, if someone offered to do 60%, let's say, of the stuff that I do, and let me worry about the 40% that's tough, that would be a great deal. Like, if there was someone that, like, fed my cats, fed the rabbits, cleaned up after the cats, cleaned up after the rabbits, took the garbage out. You know, these just repetitive tasks that, like, a lot of people have to do. All right? If someone handled those sort of mundane tasks that are very common, the rabbit one might not be that common, but the cat one's pretty common, all right? But if someone did those tasks for me that are very common, that a lot of people do, and saved my time and efforts to the things that are distinct to me, preparing my classes, grading the homework, and so on and so forth, then, wow, my life would be a lot easier. And I'd be able to really focus on the other stuff. And there's just so much work that I get. No, kidding. All right? So that's, just, in a nutshell, what the ASP.NET framework is. It's a set of components that does common functions on websites. All right? So that is the framework. That goes one better. All right, and that is we can code to manipulate those components. We can customize those components, so we have components here. We can customize them. And we can write code to manipulate them. And in fact, there's already some default code associated with those components. I think an example here is needed. Let's do the calendar example in ASP.NET. All right, using the ASP.NET framework. This will be good because this will show us again how to create an ASP.NET application, website rather, and test it and all those sorts of things. So that's what we'll do. We'll go and actually we'll create the calendar. The coding part we might not get to today. We might get to on Tuesday of next week. So let's go in here. And let's open up Visual Studio.
So I'm going to have to re-download Visual Studio to my computer. I forgot how the DreamSpark account
came. Like,
you figured out what it was?
Well, yeah, I looked through my email. I looked through the, you know, when you set up the account?
Yeah.
I looked through my LLC email. And
oh, God.
I just found a login. Right. This is different from like, the DreamSpark if you were to Google it. Because I found it the hard way.
Okay.
Yeah. Because they never made myself a DreamSpark.
Never looking at it.
Yeah. Because it's a different site. It's like DreamSpark for something academic institutions or something like that. It's a lot simpler than the new DreamSpark.
I love the little progress screens in OpenOffice. It's been a while since I installed it, but it says something to the effect like it will help you get your TPS reports done and that kind of thing. Alright, so we'll go up here, say File, New, Website. That's what we're going to do the first time we go and create this. File, New, Website. Click that. We can then go and put it wherever we want. So, I'll put it on the desktop. And I'll give it a name. And I'll click open. Doesn't exist. Do you want to create it? Yes. Now, a couple things. For this class, we'll be using Visual C Sharp. So select Visual C Sharp. At least for now, we will be using the ASP.NET empty website, so pick that. And we'll also be using the .NET for, Framework 4.5. So, probably we'll default to that, but if it doesn't, make sure you pick that. So I click OK. It does its thing. And we have on our desktop a folder that contains two files, the config file and the debug config file. All right. Now, like whenever you turn something in or email it to me, when I say turn in the site folder or the project folder or whatever, I'm talking about the folder that contains a config file. So that's the easy way to do it. If you don't see the web config file in there, then that's the wrong folder. All right? Okay. So now we can go in and we can say File, New, File. And we could create a static web page, but with HTML, but we want to start using the ASP.NET components. So I'm going to pick that I want a web form. And the default for the web form is the ASPX. So the ASPX is, again, the UI, the user interface. So it's going to contain, essentially, it's the web page. It's the analogy to the HTML document that you would have created if you were creating a static web page. All right? I do want to make sure that place code in a separate file is checked as well. Alright. By default, it gives the name default, which is the application's homepage. So make sure your application's homepage. I think in this for your first homework assignment, I think you're just making one page. So yeah, of course that's gonna be it. But in subsequent examples, if there's more than one page, make sure your home one is called default. Alright. I click Add. It does its thing. It creates the ASPX page and the .cs page. The UI, user interface, and the code behind. And if we go out into the folder, we'll see those four files now. The two config files that we got as soon as we created the app, or the website, and the two files that are associated with the page that we created. All right. One of the things that we talk about in almost all of my software development classes, whether from the intro to web development to like the Android development and Java, we talk about separating things out into components. All right. In HTML, you have your HTML page, and then you have your CSS file, and you keep them separate. The reason for that, the answer is almost always the same, maintainability. Alright? Because then I can go in and I can make one CSS file that applies to every single web page on my site. Alright? It's just easier to maintain. Think about it from a workflow perspective, too. Let's say you have someone that is a scripting guru, alright, and someone that is a CSS guru. You let them each work on their own thing, right? And then you bring them together and, you know, you can really leverage the advantages of each person on the team, assuming that you have, like, a big team, you know. In some cases, you are the sole developer, so you're the guru of everything, all right? But even then, it makes it easier to maintain. So, let's look at the ASPX file. And if you look at that, you might say to me, hey, that's just an HTML file. Yeah, it is. It is, but it isn't. All right. It isn't because we can put some other stuff in there that are not HTML tags. What other stuff can we put in there? The ASPX components. All right. So let's look on the toolbar. I'm going to click the toolbar. I'm going to pin it down. And as we look through here, there's a list of stuff that is pretty common on web pages. And one of those things is calendar. So I can go click on that and drag it over and put it in there. Notice what this looks like. I'm going to hide this again so we can see the full tag. This looks like a tag, right? Looks like an HTML tag. Alright, it uses the triangle brackets. The difference is, instead of just being a tag, it's prefixed with ASP colon. That lets you know that this is an ASP.NET control. This is not some newfangled HTML element. Alright, it has attributes, just like HTML tags can have. It has an ending tag, just like HTML tags can have. But it's not HTML. It, however, gets translated to HTML by the server. So we're going to view this page from two perspectives. From the server perspective, what lives on the server. In other words, this is sort of the recipe for making a calendar page. We're then going to run it through the server and get the actual calendar page itself. Remember, browsers don't understand ASP.NET. Browsers understand HTML. Therefore, any of these ASP.NET controls get translated into HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. It actually gets translated this one component, and this is the reason I picked this component, because this is a very dramatic example. This one line gets translated into a whole bunch of stuff. It gets translated into some JavaScript. It gets translated into some HTML. And it even gets translated to some CSS. So, I'll go and run this. Click debug. It goes and does its thing. When we're viewing it in the browser, we are viewing it from the client's perspective. All right. So in other words, the server already processed that and has delivered this to the client. This gets a little confusing because the client and the server are the same machine. This is a little development web server, and you're also the client that's browsing it. But when we're viewing it within a browser, we're seeing this. Notice that we're not accessing the file directly. We're asking our local server for this file. So the server is getting the request, is processing the request, and it translates that one ASP calendar component into this. We do a view source. We see a whole bunch of stuff. And we see exactly what you'd expect. We see a table, all right? We see TRs. We see TDs. And so on. I mentioned, too, that there's some built-in code associated with this. So, for example, you got the little arrows that say, go forward a month, go back a month. Is that code running on the client or server, do you think? It's hard to tell. It's running on the server because you kind of notice, again, this being the same, both the client and the server, there's like a little boom, little blink as you click. You can even see the server request blink just a little bit. So that leads me to believe that it is running on the server, which I'm pretty sure about. So, we've already found one example of how the controls, you know, make our life easier, all right? Because we don't have to go and code all that tedious stuff. We get this calendar and we get all the functionality associated with this calendar for free. All right, now, this isn't a complete web page, right? This would be, you know, just one component. To make it a complete web page, we'd want to do things like add CSS to it and so on, all right? How do we add CSS? A couple people asked the question in lab. Well, you can go up to File, New, File, and pick Style Sheet. Give it a name. And then you can put in there any of the things that you want. So I'll put a background.
Pieces of it. And
I was writing about the HTML that it generates and the CSS it generates, and the person who was writing the whole book was like, no, you can't do that. These people don't need to know HTML. They don't. And it's like, yes, you do. Yes, you do. So I stuck to my guns. I mean, I wrote the chapter by my style, and they decided not to use it, but I still got paid. So the moral of the story is, all right, the moral of the story is here, is, again, to be the most effective developer that you can be, don't forget that you're still ultimately writing HTML. So if I want to make that calendar go all the way across, I have to know what my hook is for CSS. Well, one of the hooks that you have would be the fact that there's an ID associated with it, and I could write the style for that. The other thing it could be is that that is a table. I know the HTML that generates is a table. So especially with CSS, but with some other kind of things as well, if you're running into problems and you're looking at, like, why did that act that way, don't forget to look at the HTML that it generates. How do you see the HTML? You bring it up in the browser, right mouse on it, and do a view source. So I should be able to go table with 100%. Now the other thing I have to do is I have to go and associate this CSS with this page. Here's where this comes real handy, because I never remember these things. Or I won't say that. I won't say I never remember them, but I always have to sit there and scratch my head. And there you go. All right, it's green, and it goes the width of the page. I was a little worried that it wouldn't go the width of the page. All right, and I'll tell you why. Because one issue that you run into, and I was prepared to lecture either way, right? I'm a pro, right? You know, I won't say I can handle any situation, but I can handle a lot of them, all right? One thing that happens is because ASP.NET generates CSS, sometimes it's CSS it generates, like, interferes with your CSS. So that's one little bit of a dilemma that sometimes you run into. But as you can see, in this case, that's not the case, and it worked. All right. Yes.
Now, a calendar might not be a good example, but let's say hypothetically you wanted to put two calendars on a page.
Yes.
You wanted to design them differently.
Yes.
When you put them both on there, does the ASP.NET give them different IDs, or are you able to?
Yes, it does. In fact, let's go and do that, because that would be a great thing to do. Like, I could go in here and create another calendar. Notice it gave it an ID of calendar 2. When I run it, they both look the same, right? Because I put my CSS on the table. Alright? If I wanted to make them both look differently, I could instead give the style rule based on the ID. Now, one thing that I have as a bad habit is a lot of times I do not go back and, like, change the IDs to make them, like, something meaningful.
Oh, yeah.
It's a good idea to do that. So, like, again, for calendars, it's probably not that big of a deal. But, like, if you start putting text boxes on your page, you know, if you have a text box for name, a text box for address, you know, go in and change it from text box 1 to text box name, text box address. Because otherwise you're going to be looking at your code and it's like, now was text box 37 the state or the zip code? You know. Oops. All right, so let's go and run this. And Now they should look different because I've done a better, more precise job of applying the style. I want to go over two more things before we're done. Number one, I'm going to hit right mouse on my default ASPX page and say open with Internet Explorer. Oh, shucks. Was that going to end well? No. We already saw it. It didn't end well. That's what we get. Why did it? Well, at least it's a mess. It's the right color mess, but it's a mess. Okay. Why did this not work? Yes.
It wasn't directed to the server.
Exactly. We opened the file directly, all right, which opened it directly in the browser as opposed to requesting it from a server, all right? The act of requesting it from a server is the act that takes the ASP.NET controls and translates them into the HTML that the browser can understand. If we look at this, if we do a view source, we'll see it has the stuff that we put in it, so it tried to open it up, but browsers don't know ASP.NET, you know? Or like I say with my food analogy, you can't eat a recipe, all right?
If it's written on edible paper, you can.
Yes, it is. In that unlikely case that it was written on an edible paper, you probably could, though it would not be near as satisfying as a sandwich would be. All right?
What if the recipe was for the recipe?
Oh, a meta recipe.
Yes.
That's beyond the scope of this class. All right. But at any rate, as you see, it tried to open up, but browsers don't understand ASP.NET. So therefore, nothing happened. The parts of this that it understood it got right, in other words, it made it the right color, all right, because it understands CSS, but the ASP.NET part, eh, not so well. The other thing I want to show you is when you come back in, let's say you finish this and you save it on disk and you close it. You go and you think, you know, all this talk about McDonald's and Subway, I'm hungry. Maybe I'll go to the Olive Garden and eat all their breadsticks or whatever. All right? And you want to open it up again. What do you do? All right? You do not do this.
Open it.
Right mouse, open in Visual Studio. You don't do that. Why not? Because these aren't individual pages. The collection of them is a web application. And it needs the web config file and all the other stuff that goes with being a web application. Therefore, what you need to do is go into Visual Studio and do a similar thing that you did when you created it. That is, wait 20 minutes for Visual Studio to fire up.
It's so cold here.
I know, it is.
Freezing. Oh my god, I need to never.
They got it.
Now, it is cold in here in this room because, like, the artificial air conditioning is making it cold. What cracks me up is, like, my daughter will say, like, it was so cold outside yesterday. It's like, it was so cold outside yesterday? What are you going to do in January, you know, when it's like 20 below, you know? I mean, it was 60 yesterday. That's not...
We adapt,
yes. Okay, so I open up Visual Studio. What do I do to open up an existing project? I go to File, Open, Website. Now, this gets a little tricky, because every now and then, students will have problems with this, or if I'm in a hurry or mess up, I screw up. If you have a folder inside a folder, you have to open up the folder that contains the web config file. So in this case, I can't see it here because that's not a folder, but example is the folder that contains the web config file, so I can open it up. Just answer yes. And now, if you run it, you're back to normal. What's on the plate for next week? We're going to look at more ASP.NET controls and see what they do. The calendar is a good one because it's so dramatic how it takes it and translates it and so on. We are then going to look at how you can programmatically manipulate those controls, because that's where the real fun starts. All right. Once you can do that, then in concept, that's most of ASP.NET. The devil's in the details, as they say. Learning about all the controls, learning how to customize the controls, and learning how to write code for those controls is sort of the next step after that. All right, we'll see you over in lab.
So an example might be like that calendar, we can make a list box, like a month or something,
Something like that. Or another thing we could do similar would be